Today is day 72 of quarantine. It's been 2 months and 10 days since the mayor of LA issued a stay-at-home order. This will be the 8th time that I'm making banana bread. While I'm at home following these quarantine food recipes, there's a parallel universe of workers behind each ingredient who are living completely different lives. The concept of time seemed to work differently for us. It's a lot slower for some people like me, who now have time to make banana bread. And faster, a lot faster, for others.
Getting orders in about 20 times as fast.
Oh my god!
We're barely able to keep up.
This is Rue, the founder of an LA boutique store that sells flour. His experience is shared by many others in the States. By the end of March 2020, flour sales increased around 150% compared to the same time last year. The flour aisles of grocery stores seemed to have emptied out overnight.
I find it perplexing. There's no shortage of flour. There's no shortage of wheat. There's no shortage of mills. There's all kinds of flour and wheat sitting there ready to jump into my belly.
So there's lots of flour to go around. The problem seemed to lie in the weak links in our complex industrial food supply chain.
Like, yeah, our food system is sort of fragile and it's sort of complicated, and that system wasn't designed to handle a sudden increase in demand.
So why not? What is slowing down our food supply chain?
It was all just a slowing of the travel from the milling facilities to the retail shelf. That component there was quite slow.
This is Nikki from Central Milling, a smaller scale mill that sells flour to local distributors like Rue. Flour produced by Nikki's company is picked up by trucking companies, delivered to distribution centers, and then finally brought to the store shelves.
All that stuff in between was affected by COVID as well. So you had a lot of distribution companies that were shutting down or minimizing the services that they offer, minimizing the hours that they're working or how much product they can handle.
Finally, there's a problem with manufacturing the packages to hold the flour.
The bag stock has been a challenge too, because, you know, not just the flour industry has seen a spike. I mean, it's sugar and everything that lives in a paper bag, you know, has gone through the roof in sales. There's only a couple manufacturers in the country that make large quantities of these 5-pound bags, and a lot of people buy from them from different parts of the food world. So it's, the bag manufacturers are struggling to keep up with the bag production.
So how did we get to this large interconnected system that when one part fails, the whole system is backlogged? And has our food chain always been like this?
Every little town had its own flour mill.
This is David Keisel, a flour miller based in Capay Valley near Sacramento. David used to work in tech as a product designer, but became fascinated by the process of producing and milling wheat.
I'm fascinated by what grains are agronomically, what they are nutritionally, and then, as I said, as much sort of culturally and socially, how they've helped form society. Milling is interesting because what I realized was that that infrastructure that had been ubiquitous in the U.S. and really worldwide, had been ubiquitous at a community level, had disappeared and quite quickly since really sort of the mid-20th century.
Milling used to be part of a town's local ecosystem, supporting local agriculture and food processors. It spurred economic activity and had cultural significance.
And the mill was the center of that traditionally for hundreds, if not thousands of years. We've lost all of that.
Today, a handful of large mills dominate the industry, and their flour is delivered to customers in an ever more complex food chain. That was the system before COVID-19. When the pandemic hit, it became obvious to David that
these consolidated national brands are not able to supply or respond to changes in local demand. What would happen if we could reestablish a model for distributed, smaller scale? If the value of the food we eat is not just calories per dollar, but support for local communities and local economies, you know, I think that we can see a shift, and I would hope that there's a possibility for a shift in what's driving the market.
The COVID-19 pandemic provided an opportunity for small-scale producers like David and Nikki and small distributors like Rue to sell directly to consumers who are searching for local sources of flour when the supply chain of larger flour companies breaks down. But the question remains, will this honeymoon phase for small community-based mills last after the pandemic?
I'd like to think so, the optimist in me.
I'm an eternal optimist, and if you're doing anything around agriculture and food production, I think you have to be. But, you know, my hope is that we come away from this pandemic with a realization of the, as I said, it's a shift in perceived value of local economies.
The story of dairy transports us to a different community, one that's usually invisible and marginalized, but is suddenly recently deemed essential when the pandemic hit. So who are the people producing most of America's food? According to the National Agricultural Workers Survey, 71% of farm workers in America are immigrants.
Anyone that works in agriculture estimates it much higher. I'd say it's more like 80% or up to 90% of farm workers are immigrants, and probably 70% or 80% of them are undocumented.
This number may be even higher for dairy farmers since they don't qualify for a temporary agricultural work visa program.
Dairy work does not fall under the H-2A program, so it's almost all undocumented immigrant workers. And dairy work requires work around the clock because cows need to be milked all times of the day, you know, 7 days a week. So it's a very labor-intensive industry.
In this industry, cows can't be milked over Zoom. Workers have to go out to work, where it's often hard to socially distance. Some farm workers in Washington were organizing demonstrations calling for sick pay, hazard pay, and adequate workplace protections.
Starting about 3 weeks ago, workers told the companies that they wanted them to provide social distancing, they wanted masks, they wanted gloves, which the companies had not been providing. Any of these things, really. And they wanted hazard pay for working under these circumstances. Now, the companies are sort of vague about what it is that they're willing and not willing to do. So, you know, they make these general statements about saying, well, yes, we're willing to provide safer conditions, but what exactly that means is not clear. And it is clear that they are not willing to pay.
Another problem that makes farm workers vulnerable to COVID-19 is their housing situation.
Even as early as March, as February, I think the first cases started coming from those workers who were living in barracks in February, where workers began testing positive for COVID-19.
I've heard of some H-2A workers living in really substandard housing, not having any access to healthcare. They're afraid to complain because if they complain, they can just be deported. They can't leave and go to another job. So their contract is with one employer.
Some of our people in that community need to live two or three families together. To pay the rent because it's very expensive.
Norma is a nurse and a community health worker, and her son works in the fields. The current living conditions of farm workers remind her of her own living situations years back.
Sometimes in one apartment, it's like 10 or more than 10 people in the same apartment. And it's dangerous.
Yeah.
Dangerous because we need to have a space, and now it's a social distance, but in one apartment is a lot of people. When I live in one apartment, it was 10 people in one apartment. And we have only one bathroom and two bedrooms, and the living room was a bedroom.
Generally speaking, the living conditions of farm workers have a lot to do with poverty. The fact that people are making minimum wage. The average wage for a farm worker family in the United States is between $17,500 and $20,000 a year. So that is a poverty wage.
You know, they're trying to save money. They're trying to send money back home. That's why they're here. And they live in very cramped conditions. They live below the poverty line in terms of their, you know, yearly income. Oftentimes farm workers are living on $11,000, $12,000 a year. They don't have access to things like food stamps if they're undocumented. And so, yeah, the living conditions are really bad. If you're an immigrant, you're not gonna get access to your stimulus check or any kind of unemployment benefits. So they're very vulnerable both physically and economically right now.
Now it's a good time to support our community. It's very important these people to be part of some program to get their papers, because some don't have papers, and it's very important these people need to be part of this community because they live here, they work here, and our kids born here.
This final story is about how flour, milk, and every other ingredient used to make this banana bread is delivered to me. This is the story of truckers and transportation workers.
I do have the fear in the back of my mind. I try to bury it because what's most important is that I'm out here helping people and I'm getting them their food. But to help alleviate some of that fear, what I do is take the necessary precautions. With me coming into contact with so many people, I don't want to endanger my family. So I definitely am mindful of that when I decide to go home. Just recently, I was off for a week. And before I was able to really interact with my family, because my sister, she just had a baby. He's 4 months old. And then she has two other little ones, you know. So I have to be mindful of the children and their mom. I don't want to get them sick or anything. So what I did was, before I actually got off the truck to go home with them, I parked my truck at one of the truck stops near home, and I just stayed there for like 2 days just to make sure that I was okay and that I wasn't, like, you know, feeling sick.
I stay out more away from my family, you know, because I feel like I'm very vulnerable out here, and it's easier for me to contract the COVID before they do. So I try to, you know, stay away from them to in order to not bring it home. But then I also feel like an alien going out in public and dealing with people, because I feel like people look at me to maybe having COVID. They treat me a lot different, you know, when I'm out and about.
In addition to feeling scared and socially isolated during this time, Kaisha also feels a sense of blame.
I go home on a break and I go into the stores and there's nothing on the shelf and there's people complaining, and the only people that they point at are the truck drivers. They blame us and they think that we're just not doing anything and we're just not delivering fast enough, and we can only do so much as drivers. When they went out, show up with less pallets than they expected, they ask, where's the rest? And I'm just like, this is all we have. Like, this is all that, you know, that was put on the trailer. And so it makes me feel like there's a shortage in some way. And it, I feel like as a driver, it puts pressure on me, because doing all that I can, I honestly feel like truck drivers aren't really getting appreciated like they should. I just wait for that moment for them to mention, you know, delivery drivers, because without truckers and delivery drivers, they wouldn't be able to have the products and the safety gear and the food and all this to, you know, basically things that make the world go around, you know.
But despite the challenges, the lack of appreciation that sometimes felt, Jess Marie is optimistic.
You know, as long as we are taking care of ourselves, I believe that we can definitely, well, we can't eliminate it, I don't think, but we'll definitely come back. Mm-hmm.